Hello, space fans, and welcome to another edition of Space Fan News. This week, the Kepler science team announced the discovery of 715 new planets. These new exoplanets orbit 305 stars, and many of them in multiple planet systems, like our own solar system. Nearly 95% of these planets are smaller than Neptune, which is almost four times the size of Earth. And if you've watched our newly released video on deep astronomy called Kepler's New Universe, you would know that this is a trend that they're seeing in the Kepler data these days. Most of the discoveries are in smaller, rocky planets, which is very exciting news if you care about finding a planet like Earth. Which we do. Well, I do anyway. So this discovery marks a significant increase in the number of known small-sized planets more like the Earth than has ever been identified before. Since the discovery of the first planets outside our solar system roughly two decades ago, verifying these planets has been a laborious sort of planet-by-planet process. Now, scientists have a statistical technique that can be applied to many planets at once when they are found in systems that harbor more than one planet around the same star. Now, this is a little confusing, but I think I understand it now. So, here's what I think they're doing. The research team used a technique called verification by multiplicity, which relies in part on the logic of probability. Kepler observes 150,000 stars and has found a few thousand of those to have planet candidates. If the candidates were randomly distributed among Kepler stars, only a handful would have more than one planet candidate. However, Kepler observes hundreds of stars that have multiple planet candidates. So the thinking goes, if the star has multiple planet candidates around them, they must be planets and not stars because already Kepler has seen hundreds of these. This means it's more likely that when Kepler does see this configuration, multiple planet candidates, they assume they must not be stars based on what has already been observed. Now using this logic, through a careful study of this sample, these 715 new planets were verified, and they're not just candidates anymore. Now, if what I just said is a bit confusing, take heart. It is for me too. I'm still trying to make sure I get it myself. So let's try this. In the press release, they gave an example to help better understand what's going on. So let's see if this helps. They said, and I quote, "This method can be likened to the behavior we know of lions and lionesses. In our imaginary savanna, the lions are the Kepler stars and the lionesses are the planet candidates. The lionesses would sometimes be observed grouped together, whereas lions tend to roam on their own. If you see two lions, it could be a lion and a lioness, or it could be two lions. But if more than two large felines are gathered, then it is very likely to be a lion and his pride. Thus, through multiplicity, the lioness can be reliably identified in much the same way multiple planet candidates can be found around the star." Unquote. Okay, we'll see if that helps. I don't know. But we will do this. Scott Lewis and I will be talking about this some more tomorrow during Space Fan News Live at 9 o'clock Eastern Time tomorrow. So we'll go through this a bit more then. Up until now, Kepler would announce all these planets as candidates. They still needed to be confirmed. Now, they believe they have developed a way to verify multiple planet candidates in bulk to deliver the planets directly, not as candidates. So four of these new planets are less than 2.5 times the size of the Earth and orbit in their sun's habitable zone, which is the distance from a star where the surface temperature of an orbiting planet may be suitable for liquid water. You know what? I think I'm going to stop identifying what habitable zone means from now on. You guys have been watching long enough now that I think you all know what a habitable zone is, so I'm not going to do that anymore. One of these new habitable zone planets, called Kepler-296f, orbits a star half the size and 5% as bright as our sun. Kepler-296f is twice the size of Earth, but scientists do not know whether the planet is a gaseous world with a thick hydrogen-helium envelope, or if it's a water world surrounded by a deep ocean, or exactly what it is. This latest discovery brings the confirmed planets count outside our solar system to nearly 1,700, and, as they say in the release, quote, "As we continue to reach toward the stars, each discovery brings us one step closer to a more accurate understanding of our place in the galaxy." Unquote. Next, astronomers trying to detect dark matter using the large underground xenon dark matter detector. Whoa, come on, how cool of a name is that? Have still not been able to find any dark matter with it in spite of the fact that they just made it 10 times more accurate. One of the leading theories as to what makes up dark matter is that they are weakly interacting massive particles, commonly called WIMPs. As the name implies, they do not react with normal matter very often, you know, the weakly interacting part. But when they do, the Lux Dark Matter Detector, that is known for short, is designed to find it. Okay, now get this. The detector consists of a third of a ton of supercooled xenon in a tank with light sensors, each capable of detecting one photon at a time. Now, as WIMPs pass through the tank, they should, on very rare occasions, every once in a while, bump into the nucleus of a xenon atom in the tank. Those bumps cause the nucleus to recoil, creating a tiny flash of light and an ion charge, both of which would be picked up by the Lux sensors. The detector is more than a mile underground at the Sanford Underground Research Facility in South Dakota, where it is shielded from cosmic rays and radiation that might interfere with a potential dark matter signal. So the key to finding these WIMPs is being sure you can identify that recoil. Now, back in October, they ran the detector for 90 days and didn't see anything. No recoils and no flashes of light. And to make sure it was working right, they went back and improved the calibration accuracy of the instrument by firing neutrons directly into the detector. The neutrons acted as a stand-ins for the WIMPs because they produce a recoil similar in the detector to what a WIMP would do. Now, all of this increased Lux's accuracy by about a factor of 10, and this demonstrates, according to the team scientists, that the null result from October was absolutely robust. If there were any bumps into the xenon tank during that first run, scientists are positive they would have most definitely have seen them. This means that whatever dark matter is, it ain't WIMPs. So, where does that leave us with the question of dark matter? Well, that's a good question. This experiment wiped out a whole bunch of possibilities about what dark matter is. Lots of theories died this week. Now, they are going to fire up Lux again later this year and begin a second run. This time for a whole year, searching for new dark matter models, and again this time with much greater accuracy. I'll let you know. Finally, recent observations of the swarm of small galaxies around our closest galactic neighbor, the Andromeda Galaxy, has uncovered evidence of a merger between two dwarf galaxies. In case you didn't know, Andromeda is surrounded by a swarm of small galaxies. So far, astronomers have counted more than 20. And they also have very imaginative names like Andromeda 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. And researchers from the Dark Cosmology Center at the Niels Bohr Institute, another cool name, among others, have analyzed measurements of the stars in the dwarf galaxy Andromeda 2 and found a stream of stars moving around differently than the rest in a very coherent way. These stars are situated in an almost complete ring and are rotating around the center of the galaxy. The dwarf galaxy Andromeda 2 is very small, less than 1% of the Milky Way. The rotating stream of stars in the galaxy is entirely made up of old stars, and from their properties, researchers can draw conclusions about what's going on. They believe we are seeing the remains of a collision between two dwarf galaxies. Now, mergers between such small galaxies are expected during the galaxy formation process, but they don't happen much during the present day, and it's certainly not been seen before. Andromeda 2 is the least massive known example of merging galaxies so far, and illustrates very nicely what galaxy formation looks like at the lowest galactic mass scales. Well, that's it for this week, space fans. Thank you for watching, and as always, keep looking up.